The key to success is everyday success. That's the only key there is. So if you get up in the morning and say, okay, wow, what's the key to success? Why haven't I succeeded? Well, everyday success is the key. So you have to succeed today. It's that simple. And you have to catch the wow moments, which I did this, have done this morning and will do in this video. You have to recognize you may be making tremendous success, but if you don't take it in the right way, then you'll miss it and you'll feel like you're failing. So I saw something this morning. It's very important. That is the personality, the ego, dance of continuity, fear, is a liar. I mean, it's promoting a path that doesn't work. Let's put it that way. It's promoting a path that doesn't work, which is try to make illusions real and then get rid of them. So everything it says, the direction it's going is wrong. And so it's given bad advice. We're getting bad advice from the ego personality, continuity, dance of continuity, fear. That's what it is. As it advises us, that's the dance that we're doing, dancing to its tune. And so when it tells us that it's the only advisor there is, this is the only path there is, if you drop this path, there's no advisor, there's no way to get familiar with anything else, there's nothing else, it just you're doomed. Well, that's a lie too. The first lie that the ego tells us is that there is no other way, there is no other advisor. If we drop the ego, we're annihilated, we're helpless, hopeless. That's a lie. But people believe that. They say, well, yeah, the ego's a liar, but I believe this most important issue, it's telling the truth there. Yeah. It's not. Now, what the world wants, you come into this world, what they want success, right? But they want success the ego's way, the personality's way. They say, help make the personality happy, help the ego, we're having trouble with this path, help us succeed at this path. They don't ever think that maybe the path they're on is wrong. They're going down the ego's path, the personality path, again, which is to try and convince ourselves that reality has been changed, and therefore it's no longer real. And so there's no reality, no home, no identity to go home to. We can just stay with the personality, body, identity. And then we think the continuity fear will vanish. The continuity fear tells us it will vanish. Well, that's lying too. That's a lie too. Cloudy day. It's going to rain tonight. About a half inch. The whole mood has changed here. It's just boom. Yesterday was a glorious, glorious day. Today, very different. Totally different. Amazing how the mood shift, what the moods of weather shift. So the people here say, oh, we're failing, we're suffering. Well, come on, help us succeed. And someone comes in and says, okay, I'll help you succeed. They say, great, okay. Let's, they never consider that they need to switch advisors. They say, no, I've got to keep the advisor. I just want to be able to follow its advice better. I'm screwing up. No, it's the advice that's wrong. We think we're failing, but it's the advice that's the failure that we've been getting. We're trying to follow advice that doesn't work, and then blaming ourselves for the failure instead of the continuity fear, and blaming our efforts instead of the continuity fear, which has to be evaporated. That's different than following advice. It has to be evaporated. Like putting some water out in the sun, it evaporates. And evaporation is not something you can grasp. Grab a hold of, or there's a chunk of it or something. It's a familiarity issue that we have. It's not a learning issue. It's a familiarity issue. This is why you see people, in the past here on the spiritual path, they spend their whole lives on it, and you say, why are they doing this? What do they hope to gain? I don't see them really making much progress or whatever, and they're grasping it or something. It's a familiarity issue. The path is a familiarity situation. That's why I say everyday success is the only success there is. Everyday success is the only success there is, because we're dealing with a continuity issue. We don't. And if we have gaps in that, keep putting all these gaps in our familiarity, then it starts feeling strange to us, you know, and unfamiliar. And so we're not going to want to dwell in what is unfamiliar territory, even if it seems real nice, really great. For example, let's say if you're going to a vacation somewhere, and you've never been there, you're like, oh, I don't know, how's it going to be, and you're a little jittery, oh, I hope it's this way, and you get there, and, you know, it different than your expectations, and you have to adjust, and then maybe you go back again, and then again, and again, and gradually, you know, you get familiar with the place. So let's say you're going there again, you say, oh, yeah, no problem, I'm not all jittery, I'm not worried about anything, I know it's what to expect. I know what to expect. It's very nice. It's a very nice place. Oh, I know what to expect. Yeah. This just like that. Let's say you're traveling to a distant place that feels very nice, very beautiful, and you do it over and over and over again. Then you feel, it feels like a second home, and eventually it feels like this is my real home. So first we make the truth like feel like a second home to us. You know, this is my second home. And then ultimately we realize, this is my real home, and this world is just a temporary second home. So there's no path but the path of familiarity. Which means it takes time and effort. There's no path that isn't a commitment that you don't commit your time and effort to. It's impossible. You cannot do it any other way. This has to be emphasized. It's not being emphasized in this world enough. Now, how you do it, I mean, as far as the style, this can vary widely. We think, oh, I gotta go into some Zen monastery and sit there, you know, and do it. No. You can do it wherever you are. It's just a matter of committing the time and the effort and the focus and the right practice of wow, instead of thinking. The effort to glimpse truth and recognize your mistakes. Oh my gosh, you know, I thought it could fix the personality. The personality needs to be fixed, you know, which is what we all are trying to do, we think, well, we're following the right advice, it's just the person, nothing wrong with the personality or something. No, the personality is nothing but a dance of continuity fear. There isn't any self there, it's just the advice of fear, continuity fear, advising us what to think, what to believe, how to act, where to go, what to do, all this. And we think, and we're told, oh, that's a self that's there. No, there's no self there. It's just actions and thoughts, and based on the advice we're getting from continuity fear of how to be happy, how to find peace of mind. It's the spirit that is looking for peace of mind. And so it's trying to make some other self, we call it personality, trying to make that real. And so it's following the advice of continuity fear to have all these actions and thoughts and hoping that this will coalesce and crystallize into some new self. And then continuity fear promises, well, it'll disappear then once we concretize this new self. So we're trying to concretize a new self through thoughts, attitudes, feelings, actions, belief. You know, all this mental projection. But it's all just our mental projection. Projection doesn't leave its source. So we cannot create a separate self, you know, we cannot have an effect that separates from cause. We cannot. But that's what we're trying to do. So I know a lot of people say, well, I don't want to be locked up in a nunnery my whole life or a monastery my whole life. It seems so dreary, seems so, But, I mean, how many hours of TV do people watch every day? Probably, what, 2.5, 3.5, 4.5. Some people watch it all day. How about using the time that people spend on newspapers, internet, news, articles, obsessing about food, on movies and television, books, all that stuff? How about spending at least half of that time spiritual practice, you see, familiarity practice? It's just familiarity practice. Because we're gonna have, everyone has got 24 hours in a day, and you're gonna, if you live, 90 years, that's a lot of hours, right? So we're gonna spend those hours in some way. Why not spend a chunk of that on getting familiar with truth? It's a no-brainer. The problem is people look back on their lives and they say, where did it go? I just frittered it away. Entertainment, television's a great way to fritter away your life. That's why it's extremely dangerous, very, very, very dangerous. Television is. It sucks you in. You start watching before you know it. It sucks your hours away. Computer is the same thing, if you allow it to. I have to severely restrict my computer use in terms of. I just go to the, watch, check the weather, check Bay Area sports, and this YouTube channel, I think, and then like maybe a slideshow software or something. But I mean, it's severely restricted. I mean, very rarely, am I clicking on any links or anything, because it'll just evaporate your time severely. And so anything I do on the internet is related to spiritual focus, pretty much so. Man, on television, you can't find anything. Nothing. It's a complete desert. Wasteland. It's a wasteland. Worse than a wasteland. It's a wasteland with, poisonous animals and insects and all that. There's a mudslide in Mexico back in 1959, I think it was. It was terrible because when the mountainside came down, somehow these floods, there were hordes or massive plagues of deadly scorpions and snakes came out of the hills somehow and into the homes, and so many people died from that. So, the world is like that. It's like television. It's just like these. It's like an extremely nasty scorpion and deadly snakes, and you spend time on that. It bites you. It's gonna sting you, and you're gonna look back on your life, and you have no familiarity with truth. And then the person, of course, the continuity first says, "Oh, you don't need familiarity. You can just think it." But that's personality advice. Thinking the truth. Instead of wowing, getting wow, this wow experience with that's familiarity. When you feel this wow, you're getting familiar with truth. But the wow has to be in relation to glimpsing truth. It's not some, wow, look at that attractive personality or something. Look at that attractive body. Look at this nice car. Wow, look at this house. Wow, look at, that's not the wow we're talking about, really. But however the wow comes, it's a remembrance of home. It's a remembrance of home. Yeah, we have to keep practicing remembrance of home. And even if we live in a super beautiful place, it's not enough. We could get in the morning, oh wow, it's a great day, great weather. No, that's not enough at all. you have to consciously keep working on, you know, working to bring, you know, glimpse the truth more and more and more and more and more. Like, for instance, last night, I realized that what we call enlightenment is really seeing that everybody else is safe, has perfect standing, and God is they're standing on a foundation of that can never be changed. So nobody needs to be liberated from anything. Everyone is, you know, there's not any possibility that anyone can ever stray from the one spiritual family. This is what really gives us the relief, because what we're really afraid of is that there's some who are pursuing this other self that are somehow going to be lost to the one family, which will break up the one family, and will be inconsolable about that. So we're really afraid of the being, you know, this inconsolableness, a spiritual inconsolableness of some are going to separate. And what we have to see is this is not true. This is not true. That everyone, without exception, there's no way that that projections can ever leave, effects can ever leave the cause. Projections can never leave the source of projection. We're projecting the belief in another self. But this believed in other self is 100% within the mind as just a mental projection, trying to dissociate, but it's still entirely coming from the mind and is sustained by the mind entirely, and it's not a separate self. So nobody will ever attain a separate self. This is what has to be seen. It's not, you know, my enlightenment, just me, it's everyone. That's what's important. What we're concerned about lost sheep, you know. We don't, are any sheep really going to be totally lost? No. This is why the theology of Christianity, this mistake they make, the idea of eternal damnation is a terrible, terrible mistake that they have made. It's not Jesus's mistake. It's the personality. They're taking it in a personality way. They say, "Oh, okay. What could be worse than to believe that some of our members of one family, the one spiritual family that is entirely loved, we all have this perfect love for all, that some of them, a chunk of them, are going to be annihilated, tortured forever, and annihilated, and will lose them forever. This is the most hideous belief ever. And fortunately, it's entirely untrue. Entirely untrue. But you can see the trouble coming in this world. These beliefs of a continuity fear has fashioned, and then claims that Jesus is supporting these beliefs, which is nonsense. It's very difficult to. I've had a prohibitively difficult time here. No matter how we work at it, you know, it's just so ingrained and entrenched in so much. This is just one example. There's so many examples, but it's a pretty egregious example. It's the opposite of opposite emphasis of what you want. That it, what the truth is, no matter what anyone pretends, they're still exactly the way that God created them, which is perfect. No matter how much someone pretends to the contrary, they're still exactly the way that God created them, and they can't change what they are in the slightest bit. This is the real truth that Jesus tells us, that our spirit knows, the Holy Spirit tells us, the great sages tell us. But the person, the belief in the personality has to believe, since it doesn't work, what we're trying to do doesn't work. It has to come up with a reason why. And it says, some personalities can make it, but some can't. And we're in the good category, and there's others that are in the bad category. So you end up having to make categories of winners and losers in terms of personality. Because you feel like, well, I'm not winning. You know, why am I not winning? Oh, you know, well, somebody, you know, so you project the losing. You know, it's really impossible what we're trying to do. Get rid of continuity fear by changing reality. It's impossible. So we project this impossibility in a way of saying, well, there's some that can't do it. So we get free. We think we get free of it. Our own feeling that this is impossible. We say, no, it's possible, because we project it out on others and say, well, they're the losers. They're going to be eternally damned. They're never going to make it. So we think we've gotten rid of this feeling within us that we're never going to make it on this path. The direction we're going is futile. So we project it on others and then condemn them to eternal destruction, eternal failure. You know, the personality looks at it as destruction. You know, when it projects it, and it says, "Well, I'm okay. Yeah, I'm okay." But they over there, no, they're going to be destroyed. So this then creates a terrible conflict in none of it's true. None of it's true. But the personality thinks, "Oh, okay, I feel better now because I thought I was going to fail, but they're the failures, not me." And then you form this clique, a cult, where it says, "We're, you know, personality cult says, you know, we're the ones who are going to see. We're God's chosen people." Saying we're God's chosen people is a personality cult, plain and simple. Plain and simple. Now, the Jewish people have a problem with this, saying we're God's chosen people historically, right? Historically. They're not the only ones. I mean, everybody in the world, if you go around, they feel they're God's chosen people. This is a personality cult, okay? But this Jewish personality cult got into Christianity because they came out of this. The Jews were the ones who pushed, you know, gave birth to Christianity and pushed it forward. And, of course, some were not that way. I mean, they got it, but a lot didn't. They kept thinking this whole idea of, well, we're God's chosen people, we're God's children, is still within Christianity, and the others are not. And if they're not, they're condemned. This is a personality cult. This is a personality cult. No question about it. But it's a big cult. The problem is we define cults as small little groups, insular groups. If there's some huge billions and billions, you know, well, that's not a cult. A person. Yes, it is. It's just a big personality cult. And just because there's a few people, it doesn't make them a cult. You know, they may be the ones who have it right, and it's just everyone else has it wrong. But we think just numbers. Oh, yeah, okay. It's big. It can't be. No, it is. It's a personality cult. God's chosen people. You know, the Chinese have thought that way, the Japanese have thought that way, the Indians sort of feel that way, I know. They're very feeling that they're this, you know, the true God's true spiritual people who really understand the truth. And this is personality. This is a personality cult. Japanese thought, you know, the God came down from heaven and the emperor was a descendant of ours. Connection with the divine, and they're God's chosen people, very much that way. Chinese feel they've been around forever, and they're the ones, true chosen ones. And you know, the Germany, the Nazis felt they were the ones, you know. And it goes on and on and on and on and on and on. We're not trying to say just this one or that one. I mean, historically, the Jewish idea that we're God's chosen people on this planet, and God has a special purpose and choice for us. It's a slippery slope because there can be people who are oriented towards truth and they're dedicated to that. If for instance, Jewish people, they have tried to be very disciplined throughout history, but it's very easy for that to be turned into a personality cult, actually, which is basically is what has happened. Christianity too, it's right, you know, the way it is, it's more of a personality cult, much more now than a really telling the truth. The truth is not told really through these large cults, personality cults. They kind of put lipstick on the pig, but you know, hey, we're talking truth here, so we have to say these things. It's personality cult. It's a projection of our own, the failure of the direction of continuity fear is advising us in. Instead of saying the advisor is wrong, the advice is wrong, we say, no, the advice is right, and project the failure we're feeling from this advice onto others and claim that, no, we're God's chosen people. We can get it right, but they over there, they can't get it right, and so they're doomed to futility, you know. This is not right teaching, you know, that we're hearing in this world. But, you know, standing up to this is, you know, standing up to the entire world. The whole place is a personality cult, actually. And, you know, I can say this, but how do you push it out into the world? You know, I mean, because everyone, if you talk to, they say, well, you may be right, but I can't stand up to it. This is what I've gotten in my life. They say, well, yeah, I hear what you're saying, and you're probably right, but, you know, what can we do? You know, we're just inundated here. So it's just too tough. And this is how people feel now, that it's just too difficult. They just, the and I, you know, I can't really, I would say it's very difficult. I wouldn't say it's too difficult. It's very difficult. Yeah. No doubt about that. Because the notion that historically we've got it all wrong, and we got it all wrong now, it just seems overwhelming. But it's true. We've gotten it all wrong here. There's zero damnation. Absolutely zero damnation. No one's ever done a thing to change what they are, change reality. No one can ever create a separate self. Not even the tiniest bit. So nothing has gone wrong. There's no way it can ever go wrong. Everyone is completely blessed forever, has perfect standing in reality. These are the facts. And what people say is, well, how can I convince the personality that I never can convince? Well, there isn't any self there to convince, actually. This is why we have to get familiar. People call it the realization of no self or something. Well, that's sort of a backwards way of saying it. It's a way of saying it, but we just need to get familiar with this looking in the right direction, looking in the right direction. They're really saying the realization is there isn't any self. The personality is not a real self at all. We're just trying to make this conglomeration of projections into a self, you know, a true identity, which is not possible. And when we say, well, we can't change other people's minds very easily, well, maybe it's not necessary, really, because they're just trying to do the impossible. It's just enough to take our own damnation projection off of them. When we no longer need to project our own failure onto others, because we've dropped failure. So there's no failure in us. We've now listened to the truth and realized that there's nothing to be liberated from at all. There's no self to be liberated from. There never will be. Then, so when we no longer have any failure within us, because we've realized, accepted the truth, then we won't project failure upon anybody else, our failure upon anybody else. So then I believe we'll be able to see the truth that they too, there's no failure in them whatsoever either. So I believe it's not, so we don't have to change people's minds. We just have to drop our own projection of a failure upon them. And then we won't be bothered by their struggles anymore. We'll have compassion, but we won't be fundamentally freaked out by it in the slightest bit. So this is a huge insight that just, you know, arose. I mean, it just happened just as I was speaking. So, a tremendous wow here. We keep thinking we have to save people from failure, but it's only our projection of our own failure onto them that we're seeing, actually. When we succeed in recognizing there's nothing to be liberated from at all, then we realize we're a perfect success. There's no failure in us whatsoever. If failure is impossible. There's nothing to fail at. It's not that we're a success, it's that there's nothing to fail at, actually. Then we don't have any sense of failure within us, no need to project it. And so then it'll seem as if everybody's suddenly free of failure. You know, they're wonderful. Everything's wonderful. The world's wonderful. Everything's wonderful. Just like that. Without having to do anything. So it's necessary to see it like this before you can be a teacher really and help others, because you cannot see your own projected failure upon them, or you cannot help them. It's not possible. So there's nothing to fail at. There's nothing to be liberated from. Saying that, well, we're failures in trying to destroy ourselves. Well, that's not a, how is that a failure? I mean, in other words, we're perfectly untouched. So that's a success, you would say. So the only failure that we're thinking is really a success. We're successfully unable to harm ourselves. Now, the trouble is that we think, well, that might be 90% that way, but what about the other 5-10%? You know? There is no other 10%. It's 100%. So it's this 100%-ness that we focus on the real path of awakening, of dropping our projections, of calling our projections back home, is a really better way to put it. We can't really drop them. That's not quite the right word to use, because they still be separate from us. No, we call them back home. They're not separate from us, our projections, none of them. When all our projections have come back home, we realize, oh, there's no failure. None of them were lost in the wilderness. None of them were cast aside. None of them were separate. And then there's no more need to project failure on anyone else. So there's no nothing to struggle with in the world. The struggle stops. The fear stops. There's no more. No more cause for it. Now we are moving. Some are moving in this direction, you know, getting out of the personality cults of that constantly spring up in this world. So we could look at the past as a time when we were struggling, trying to deal with it halfway, kind of a half-hearted halfway effort, and then realize that that doesn't work. This is the lessons of history. The lessons of history should tell us that the half-hearted halfway effort to compromise, say, well, there's some self to the personality, some projections can never come home. Some are separate and some aren't. So there's some failure and some that are success. This doesn't work. This should be the lessons of history that we learn now. Obviously, it hasn't, what we've done hasn't worked well. Hasn't worked historically. So, but instead of, saying, oh, all is lost now, we say, oh, okay, great. I understand why it didn't work. And so now I can correct that mistake. All we're doing is correcting the big mistakes. You correct the big mistakes, that takes care of it all. Little ones are part of that. It's like leaves are part of a tree. Get to the roots of the tree, the big mistakes. Projecting our own sense of impossible failure onto others and claiming that, well, they've sinned against God and they're going to be destroyed, annihilated. But we, because we're projecting our failure, God likes that. We're going to be saved. Because the continuity fear says projection is salvation. So, in following this advice, we think, oh, we're projecting our failure onto others, that therefore we're God's chosen one, so that we're the ones who are going to be saved because we're projecting the way that the continuity fear has advised us, and we think continuity fear is God, the advice of God on how to be happy. There's so many in the world think, yeah, we're going to be saved, because they said we're heavy into projection. God likes that, so God likes us. What they don't understand is those that are projecting, they're projecting failure upon those other ones are also listening in continuity fear, and they're also projecting their failure onto you. So this is why conflict happens in the world historically. Look at the conflicts we've had now. There's different types of conflicts, some armed conflicts, some ideological, a lot of different ways for conflict to arise. But it's inevitable. Follow the continuity fears of isolation projection, and you will be engaged in conflict, always faced with conflict. Continuity fear says, well, there is no other advisor. I am God. There's no other advisor. If you stop listening to my advice, you're doomed. You're going to be the one that's going to be projected upon. You're going to be the failure, because you're not projecting. If you stop projection, well, you're going to be the one that is annihilated. This is the fear that continuity fear provides. This is why these some religious aspects or this personality cult, they're terrified. I'm like, if I stop projecting, God's going to kill me. God's going to destroy me. God loves projection, lives by projection. Well, of course, continuity fear is kept alive by projection. It's kept going by projection. To evaporate it, we need to stop projecting. And then sit in the wow of that, that evaporates the continuity fear because you say, wow, I can handle it. I can handle it. I've gotten familiar with it, so I don't need the continuity fear anymore. This is the only way. We have to get familiar with not needing the continuity fear, which is to stop bit by bit, stop projecting. Find out what real truth is, and that we don't need to do anything at all. Don't need to try and form a new self, separate self. This is just an attempt to deceive God and trying to be greater than God. We don't need to do any of that. So there's no need for any projection, really. And we just get used to this bit by bit by bit, then we say, oh, I don't need that continuity fear anymore. I don't need that. And so there's less feeling of fear of damnation, right? Of giving up projection. The fear of damnation is coming from the fear of giving up projection, because continuity fear tells us, well, if we do that, you will be damned, because I'll hate you. You know, you're trying to attack me. Continuity fear says, oh, you're trying to get rid of God, huh? Again, continuity fear says that projection is God. All thanks to Jesus for pointing all this out, you know, in our modern vernacular, in our modern culture. Other sages have gotten to the same, you know, same explanation, understanding within the times and the culture and the shorthand of the day, which doesn't always translate well throughout the different epochs, etc. So we have this, you know, an explanation for these times right here, right now, that very much, you know, clarifies it for us, very much clarifies it for us. And this is not to detract from other efforts historically at all. It's just, it just happens that a lot of norms shift and change, customs shift and change, language shifts and changes, you know. So one explanation historically may feel awkward at another time, a little bit awkward. So you want something that's updated right here, right now. This is it. Thanks to Jesus and A Course in Miracles, he gave out this information that I'm going over with you right now, that we're sharing together here, walking together in the wow. And I certainly can see it. You know, I see it the way he's presenting, and I say, oh, yeah, I can really relate to that, relate to this. And it's true. It's true. This is how continuity fear operates. It claims it's God, and projection is how God functions. This is what continuity fear tells us. If we stop doing that, we say, well, you'll have no function in reality then. You become non-functional if you stop projecting. This is the fear. If we stop projecting, we're afraid we'll become non-functional. But what actually happens is we find ourselves in abidance. That's our functioning. But to the continuity fears, well, you're not functioning. There's no function there. There's no projection. You got to project. But then it says, I'll give you a good projection. Don't worry. We'll and sometimes you get an insight and just, you got to stop right away. I just got one. Just, wow. To continuity fear, functioning means projection. So if you're not projecting, it says, continuity fear says you're not functioning at all. You have no function. So you're annihilated, no function. And this is not true. Abidance is a function. So we're getting to the nitty gritty here, and the wow is strong. Now, what I just saw is I saw that abidance is possible. The prospect of it suddenly became increasingly probable to me. So this is the wow. Not necessarily the insight I had in relation to projection. That secondary, when we'd seen that, I suddenly said, oh, I can see it now. Which means what? Oh, abidance is very likely for me. You see, then this is the wow that hits. Success. In other words, success is very likely. Because there's nothing to succeed at projection-wise at all. Don't need to that abidance. You know, this is being cleared up, so. So this is the shock when you see that success is, you see, hey, it's really possible for me. This is the shock, the wow. And this is what has to be recognized. Don't go chasing after more insights, because the powerful feeling of I just saw that abidance really is possible here. Wow. To send shockwaves, you know, throughout the entire construct. The core construct, that we're, the core, which is all just a projection. There's actually no concretization at all there. There's a complete absence of any concretization whatsoever. Once spirit gets a glimpse at this inner dynamic, the wow arises. I mean, it's spirit that is in the wow state. You know, we just have to go along with it physically, functionally here. You sit quietly, don't try to do anything fancy or anything. It's spirit that saw this, and it saw its freedom, you know. It's just like, wow. And this reverberates throughout all the remaining projections. Something very interesting happened yesterday. I may be, you know, have been dirt poor my whole life, actually. I've had to rely on other people to sustain me. And have, you know, very lowly position, one of the lowest positions possible, socially, status-wise. So, to me, the whole world just overlooks me entirely. I'm nothing. I'm a nobody. This has been my whole life. I'm a nobody. Just everybody just looks right past me, and there's nothing to see there, you know. Nothing to see there. Very brutal experiencing. But there's this waiter. There's a waiter in a restaurant. There's one who, he's so good at what he does. He makes you feel like you're the king or queen of the universe, you know? That's how he treats you. Like, it's like, oh my gosh, you've come to see me. You know, I'm so blessed by this. You know, the king and queen of the universe have come to see me. Wow. You know, he treats you like a total VIP. Total VIP treatment. No matter who you are, it doesn't matter. I mean, and the only person is, it's only happened one time in my life that I've been treated like a VIP. It was this waiter. Now, it's their job to do this, right? But he's the best waiter in the world. There's no doubt about it. He actually is. I'm not the only one that feels this way. I found out. Everybody feels this way. He treats everybody that way. So, I didn't know where this waiter went to. You know, it's been quite many years. But I found out where he is. I found out. I just stumbled across it on the, you know, internet. And I said, oh my gosh. And the reviews are just like, everybody just says, this guy's the greatest waiter in the world. He's just unbelievable. Treats you like a total VIP. And I never forgot that. I said, somebody treated me like I really, I'm important, I matter. You know, that just, I'm a VIP for no reason, you know. I mean, it's just, this is what I didn't say, well, I've done this. He didn't ask me, what do you do? Are you, you know, oh, you're an important person? No. He just says, wow, you know, you are, I'm so, this is just awesome that you came here to my table, you know, so I can wait on you. It's just totally awesome. I mean, I'm so completely blessed that you came here to my restaurant to see, you know, if I can wait on you. This is all, what can I do for you? My gosh, let me just, whatever you want. You know, he treats you like you're like the top royalty in the world. I mean, you know, this is the kind of service you get. You would think, well, this is the kind of service an emperor or an empress gets. You know, where just the slightest whim, whatever. And he says, look, you know, oh, what, you know, there's something that I can do for you that makes you feel, you know, that you're truly worthy, you know, whatever it is. If I need to stand, do a handstand or, you know, sing you a song, you name it, whatever it is, you know, I'm just here to do that for you. And it's just like, so, wow. Going to see that waiter again, you know. That's like going to see a guru. This is the way like a enlightened sage is like. Because they're no projection of failure upon you. So they see you, oh, you're perfect. You have perfect standing. Your perfection is my perfection, you know. And so they're just like, you know, just overjoyed to see everyone. And just like, wow, my gosh. It's so wonderful that I'm so blessed that one of my family, perfect spiritual family, I'm getting to spend some time with them and just hang out with them. It's like that. This waiter's like, you know, it's like one step below an enlightened sage, kind of. I don't know. Maybe he is an enlightened sage and we don't know it. It's possible, isn't it? But it just goes to show how overlooked we all feel in this world because of all the projection of failure. We all feel like we're nobody, you know, and potentially nobody. See, here's the thing. Even the big shots feel that potentially they're nobody because if they stop projecting, they're going to be nobody. They're going to be annihilated. And deep within them, they feel like, ah, I hate projecting. What happens if I stop? You know, I'm doomed. So everyone in this world carries this feeling of potential doom within them. Not just, you know, asteroid doom or anything like that, but I mean spiritual doom, annihilation doom. We all carry that with us. So we all feel that way. So when you get somebody that treats you like, hey, you know, I don't see any failure in you whatsoever. It's impossible. I mean, you're awesome. Let me cater to your every whim here, and it's not like he's trying to like show you that like he's doing his job, but it's like he's like genuinely feeling like, my gosh, what a great opportunity. My dearest friend has come here to have, you know, lunch here. What can I do for you? This is just awesome. You never see that. I mean, this waiter is so much better than the other waiter. You cannot even compare. He's a genius at it. I mean, he's a virtuoso. And I read the reviews. I mean, it's just like I went on and on and on, hundreds. Everybody says the same thing. Says, this guy's the best waiter I've ever had in my life. This guy's unbelievable. Everybody feels that way. He said, I'm just going back there just to, you know, to get the service. I mean, he can serve me dirt and it would be fine. I wouldn't care. Because the way he served it, you know, the way he takes care of everything, he says, oh, man, you know, if you want, you know, better dirt, I'll get you better dirt. You know, what can you have with this dirt? Whatever, you know, you name it, you know, don't worry about anything. I'll take care of everything for you. It's on me, you know. Oh, it's your birthday? It's on me. I'm going to bring you a cake. You know, I'll tell the chef, best cake. And no, it's free. Forget it. It's your birthday? Oh, my gosh, it's great. Here's the cake, for, you know. No, really, he does that. It's on me. It's on me. Whatever you need, if it's anything important, it's on me. Yeah, and so, I mean, there are some waiters, waitresses, we'll just use waiter, you know, somebody who's waiting on a table, who they're very talented at what they do, they're good. Okay. But this one is a whole different category. I mean, a celebrity waiter, you know, if there's such a thing, he's a celebrity waiter to say for sure. He's in this echelon, you know, of greatest waiters in the world. There's no doubt about it. I mean, I'm sure somewhere in the world there are others, right? But there is that, it's a whole significant different category. You can tell. You can absolutely tell. You can go to the most expensive restaurants in the world and super professional waiters and everything, but it's still not going to be that upper echelon, because he really makes you feel like you're the most important person in the world. You feel it. And so it's pretty amazing to have that experience. It just blows your mind. You know, I said, nobody's ever treated me like this. You know, no matter what, I can drop $1 million, you know, at a casino. They're still not going to treat me like this. You know, they have these people in casinos who you know, hang out with the high rollers and make them feel like they're super important. A lot of party girls and stuff like that do that. You know, the casinos hire these people. But they can't touch this guy. No way. Because you wouldn't have to, you could just order like an arugula salad, you know, in his place. And they say, that's absolutely great, you know, wonderful, you know, love it. It's not like you have to drop a bunch of money. If I had $1,000, you know, I'd tip him $1,000. Yeah, there's no question about it. I mean, the experience I had there was invaluable, actually, invaluable. Because he's not projecting failure on you. You know, he's not projecting his own stuff on you at all. Not at all. Now, how he does this is extraordinary. I don't know. And he does it to everybody. This is what I just found out. He does it to everybody. It wasn't just us, it was everyone. So he don't feel he has any issues, you know, that he's projecting upon you or anything. So, that's a, you know, I mean, I spend it, you know, that's a meal. I mean, it's just worth it just to go, you know, to this waiter and just, and, you know, you'd fly around the world to go to a waiter like this. He's not projecting any issues upon you at all and treats you like you're the world's greatest VIP. I mean, where do you get that experience in this world? Where? We spend a lifetime of earning and spending, and we never get this experience, do we? Never. This is the first time I ever had that experience in my life. I've gone to see some gurus and stuff like that, but you know what? It was all about them. It was all about them. It was all about them, you know. Look what a great guru I am. It wasn't about me at all. I was just there to witness what a great guru they were, you know. This was way better. I'm telling you, it was way better. This waiter. So people fly all over the world to go see these great gurus, and they come away and say, oh God, this guru is so enlightened, you know, he's so blissful, he's so happy, oh, it's amazing, you know. No, going to see this waiter, it's like you feel like, hey, I'm important. I can relate to, I'm someone, I don't have any issues with this guy at all. There's no issues here. And he sees me as like, I feel like I'm really valuable and important. And it's not a personality thing. It goes deeper to to our core. It's like I have perfect standing with this guy, And he's super humorous and everything. It was just the whole package. It's just unbelievable. It's like meeting your best friend. It's, oh my gosh, my best friend has come to see me, And it's not an act. He does it with everybody. I mean, it comes across as a genuine experience, And so we were bemoaning the fact that it's been so many years have passed. We said, I'm sure he's not there anymore, and we'll never see him again, and it's terrible. And then suddenly last night, I know where he is now, and it's just like kaboom! Oh my gosh, this is great. I'm gonna go see him. Absolutely, we're gonna go see him. This is very exciting. I got tears in my eyes. I mean, my gosh, it's like going to see a guru. You find a with a guru. Oh, there's the guru, because this is the real gurus. Is there? There's no issues they're projecting upon you at all. They don't have any issues of failure to project upon you at all. And it's not about them, it's about you. And some who have said they've had a real guru, they say they treat you like you're their best friend. What can I do for you? It's just awesome to see you. It's not about them. But God, what a huge difference between the gurus in this world, most of them, where it's about them. Look at my attainment. Look at my enlightenment. Look at my liberation. Isn't this awesome? And you feel like this little ant. Oh yeah, you're so great. Look how loving I am. Look how this. Look at it. No, those aren't real gurus. Those are not real gurus. Now, real gurus are not slaves or nothing. They're not going to come to your house. Oh, let me be your servant. Let me clean up your yard forever. That's not what they're about. But they're about giving you this feeling that you have perfect standing without anything happening at all. You don't have to have a perfect yard to have perfect standing. So yeah, the wheels are turning to go see this waiter right now. The Holy Spirit is suddenly pulling all these strings. It's amazing. The means to do it are showing up. I don't have the means. I rely on other people. It's showing up, and we never had planned. We planned to get away, but suddenly I found this waiter is there. You're just like, wow. You'd pay, to get this waiter's table in his section. You'd pay whatever it takes. Whatever it takes. Now, Holy Spirit will arrange it. I'm sure that we can get this without having to pay, because I don't have that. I can't bribe. I can't go to the maitre d' and say, hey, here's $1,000. I sit me in that day. Got to sit in this table. And it's again, it's different. It's a different level, because it comes across as genuine. It's not some high-class place either. It's not some hoity-toity, like you're gonna drop, $1,000 for dinner there, some five-star super French restaurant or something, where the waiters are treating you great because you drop a lot of money because you're an important person. It's not like that at all. It's not like that at all. You go in there for hors d'oeuvres, spend $5, you're still gonna get the royal treatment. So it's not like you have to be an important person to get to be treated royally at all. I'm one of the most least important people on the planet. That's the way I've been treated my whole life. That's the way people view me, because they see me as a failure, because I'm dropping projection into them. That's total failure. So I'm viewed as a total failure by most of the world. I've always been so. It's very tough to handle this. You can't really handle it. You know, it's just brutal. But there's someone, you know, who you don't have to. It's not be an important person to be treated like a VIP. We always talk about it. We said, man, you know, hey, let's just get in the car and just go and let's go to this guy and just, you know, we didn't have the money to do it, is the problem. But if I would have had the money, we would have done it. We just, you know, and the drive is too long, you know. But we just say we got to go right now this weekend and just, you know, we'll drive, you know, 20 hours. I don't care what it takes. We just got to go and go sit at his restaurant. Just got to do it. This has been for years and years. We've been talking about this. We just got to do it because, you know, it gives you this feeling that you're not nobody. You know, you're not a failure. You know, for me, that's very important because from the eyes of the world, I'm a total failure. This is the trouble with, you know, the trouble is. The world views as you drop projections, you have no functionality, so you're total failure. This is what the ego tells us. If you go on that path, you're a total failure. I remember when I first started the real path of the Holy Spirit, the ego told me, you're a nobody, you're a nothing, you're going to be a total failure, absolute, the lowest of the lowest, annihilated, and it threatened me with all this stuff, and it just was horrible. This is how it views it. People just dismiss me as I'm nothing, you know. It's brutal. And the continuity first. Well, I have to find something for you to do. So what do? I pick up trash. You know, this is from a continuity standpoint. This is all I'm good for. You know, this is all I'm good for. And the waiter, he said, you know what? I like you. I like you. You guys are great. This is how he comes across. It's not what do you do or anything, what have you accomplished or anything. He just says, you know what? I really like you guys. I really do. I mean, you just made my day. This is how he comes across. Is, you know, you guys are just making my day. And then he has so positive and upbeat and light, and it's just like you feel like you are making his day. And you say, hey, I am important because I'm really made somebody happy. And he's like so happy to wait on you and see you, and he just be interested and listens to you. Oh, he says, wow, it just makes my day. And he's interested in you, you know, and oh, just saying that, just hearing that, you say that, oh my God, it just makes my day. Genius. He's a genius. He's a natural genius as a waiter. And, you know, some waiters, you know, try to do it, but you can tell that it's just an act. In this case, it doesn't seem like an act. So this is just like, you know, lit up my life, you know, to see, oh my gosh, we're going to see this waiter again. This is just, you know, this is a huge wow, a huge wow. We're working to make that happen. And it seems like it's going to happen. I, you know, pray that it will. One way or another, we're going to make it happen. Even if we just have to drive down for one day and come back, you know, it's going to happen. You know, it's worth it. It's just worth it. And it's a funny thing, because there's all these gurus in California. I don't go to see any of them because I just don't feel it, you know? I don't know why I don't feel it. Because it's about them. And they'll just make me feel even more like, you know, I don't know. It's but here, it's not about him. It's about us. So I'd rather go see this waiter than any of these gurus in the world that I know at this point. I'd rather go see this waiter. In a place that doesn't seem to have any spirituality associated with it or anything at all, you know, just an eatery, You know, I'd rather go see this waiter, honest to God. Now, is it a personality thing? Well, superficially, you know, but I would say no. You know, it resonates with the core. It resonates with the core. You know, I would advise people to go see this waiter more than I would advise them to go see some guru that, you know, in the world that I know, you know, whoever it is. Whoever it is. Really. I can't come up with one teacher on this planet that I would prefer to go see rather than this waiter, actually. Very interesting. The Holy Spirit has actually arranged everything, so I go see this waiter. This is amazing. I mean, I don't know, maybe he's enlightened. Some people have said, you know, like a taxi driver, they had us enlightened, you know. Razor's Edge, I think, was it that someone goes back after seeing Ram Maharshi and just as a taxi driver in Stockholm or something, or they're enlightened. And they say that a true yani, you don't know they're enlightened. There's no trappings of it, you know. You can't. But it's not about them. It's about you. They have no issues they're projecting upon anyone. And you never forget it. You never forget it. First time I saw again a video of Anandamayi, it was all about me, you know. I mean, I got the feeling like is like it wasn't about her at all. Now they tried to make it, the personality tried to make it about her, but her actions, the way she was acting, it was all about us, you know. She had no issues at all. And I felt this, and it was just like kaboom, this is a real guru, this is what it's really about. I said, where do you find someone like that in this world? My gosh. So, maybe we'll all convene at this, go see this waiter. Right? I mean, I don't know if you're up for it. If you're in some other, I'd fly to this waiter. I'd say, I flew all the way from Russia or something. I mean, just to see you, you know? Because I heard you're the greatest waiter in the world. This is, you know, yeah. I'd fly from India to see to have this waiter wait on me just for an hour. You know, it'd be worth it, because you may spend your entire life never getting this treatment ever, never feeling nobody projecting issues upon you. I mean, we go our whole lives and all we experience is our own projections coming back on us and everyone else projecting upon us, and we feel like really potentially we're nothing. You know. Whereas this guy, you don't feel that. So there's no chance you could be nothing. Not in my eyes. No way. Man, I got to get a tip together for this guy. I'm going to see him. Holy cow. Or you do something for him, you know? Buy him a house, buy him a car, this is the feeling, you want to buy him a house, a car, whatever, you know. Oh my gosh, you know, you maybe feel like maybe I'm not doomed. Got rid of that feeling of potential doom that we carry with us. We all carry this feeling of potential doom with us. And a real guru gives you this feeling like, no way, not as long as I exist, you know, I exist forever, and you'll never be doomed as far from I'll never leave you, you know, alone and doomed and annihilated. No way. There's no possibility of that. That is the real guru. This is the feeling they give you. And this is a different story, you know. And this is a wow. When you feel that, you just wow. Again, the first time I saw a video of Anandamayi, I saw this video. This is my introduction to her, and it was just tears just streaming down my face. I couldn't move, you know. I just said, oh my, I'll never truly be alone. You know, she will never let me be in this annihilated, doomed condition. Of course, that wears away through time, and everyone's projections come back, and gradually, you know, but I did have that experience. You know, I know what it's like. I know it's possible to have that experience where I was completely convinced, I was certain of it, that this fear of doom and annihilation, the continuity fear gives us if we stop projecting. I said, you won't allow that to happen, you know, in terms of feeling all alone and isolated and annihilated. And something says, no, no way. Should be there, you know. Say, you don't have any issues. No, you're not a failure. There's no way you're a failure in my eyes. It's impossible. So this gives this just this euphoric, you know, experience you can't get any other way. You can't get any other way because everybody else has issues they're projecting on you. When you come across someone who has zero issues, it gives you experience you cannot get any other way. No issues of failure. No, they're not projecting at all. She's not, for instance, Sri Sri Narayana was not projecting at all. No projections whatsoever. No issues. No failure. No fear of failure. No projections. Whew. Yeah, it was like, you just go into this wow condition that's so intense, but I've been through it. We can handle it. You just sit quietly. You sit quietly. It's okay. You don't spontaneously combust or fall apart or anything like that. But I'm thinking, what can I do for this waiter, you know? What can I do? I don't know. I grew a bunch of vegetables. I thought I would send them down to him, you know, here for the chef. You do something. You want to do something for him. Now, of course, it helps get tips. He gets great tips, I'm sure. But you know what? He is worth it. He absolutely earned whatever the tips are. $1 million, he's worth it. If I was a billionaire, I'd give him $1 million tip. There's no doubt about it. I mean, a billionaire still has this feeling of doom, potential doom in them. I don't care who it is. And going to see a waiter like this, for a moment you feel like, no, doom is not possible for me. It takes that feeling away. That's worth, if you're a multi-billionaire, that's worth, you know, $1 million tip for sure. For sure. What's that to a multi-billionaire? You know, it's like $100 to the rest of us. Maybe even less. Here's someone with this gift, but he's just working as a waiter, as his profession, you know? I mean, it's just some place that's not really important or anything like that. And you think, wow, but he could be making so much more money, you know? But he's just, this is what he's doing. It's just like, it's just a mind blower. He could be waiting in the best restaurant in the world. I mean, if they knew about him, they'd say, here's a five, you know, whatever you name your salary, name it. You're worth it. But he's working for peanuts. It's just astonishing. Of course, the people have no issues, no issues of fear of failure. What do they have to prove? On the other hand, they're not promoting themselves at all. I mean, how do you find them, you know? They're not necessarily going out and saying, hey, I'm a great guru, you know, come see me and find out how great of a, what a great success I am. You know, they're not doing that, really. I mean, it's not that they would be unknown, completely unknown. Like Ram Maharshi, he's just sitting in a cave. He's not promoting himself in Arunachala. And word of mouth, like this waiter, word of mouth. Hey, you got to go see this waiter. He's just out of this world. You can't believe it, how great he is. Hey, someone goes to Ram Maharshi. Oh my God, the peace around him. You just can't believe the peace around him. He's just sitting in the caves up there. He's not promoting himself, doing nothing. But you got to go see him. You know, you won't regret it. And people come. They say, oh my gosh, this is someone who has no issues at all. You got to go see this. And so word of mouth spreads out like that. It's word of mouth that happens. And but you know, I don't know how I get word of mouth. You know, it's just because I don't know anybody. Nobody thinks I'm worth knowing. You know, I don't have any friends because nobody thinks I'm worth having as a friend. They see me as on a path of total failure. So I don't know how I'd get word of mouth of this. You know, but somehow the Holy Spirit will make it happen. I mean, we just stumbled upon this waiter, totaled by divine providence. You know. We just wandered into a restaurant and sat down, and this guy said, hey, how are you? You know, it's like, wow, how's your vacation going? Do you hear my guy? Oh, great. You know, it's just like, I'm so-and-so, and just great to meet you. It just, you know, it's just like, wow, I'm going to make your meal, believe, I'm going to make it just best meal you've ever had. You know, let's get down to this, you know, and just, I'm here to just do whatever you want to do. And just, wow, we're going to really pick this thing up and make it just awesome. And just how he does it, you know, it's just, I can't even hardly imitate him. I mean, it's just almost inimitable. We just wandered into it. We just wandered into a restaurant and this is, it just sat down. And somebody had paid for this getaway for us, you know, made it possible. So, you know, this is what happened. But it's also frightening because these people move around. Some gurus, you know, the great gurus, they move around. They move, you know, how do you stay in touch with them? You know, I don't know. I don't know. You know, it's horrible. But at least they, you know, at least we know there's a path that we can drop our projections so that we're like this. So we don't have any issues either. At least I got the experience, you know, of those great gurus that I experienced it and I realized, is this possible? This is possible. They said, don't worry, drop all projection. You won't be a loser. I'll be here for you. Everybody else says that you're a total failure. Not in my eyes, you're not. You can never be a failure in my eyes. It's impossible. You're perfect. I see you as perfect. You're absolutely, unbelievably perfect. And Ananda, my mom, was that way. She said, I'm absolutely elated to be here with you. I mean, she says, I'm nothing. What am I? You know, I mean, well, not quite like that, but it's just, I'm just a little child or your little friend that I'm the one who's thrilled to be seeing you. It's not about me. I'm just, so why are you so happy? He says, because I'm with you. Because I'm here with you. I'm visiting with my best friends. That's why I'm happy. She didn't say, well, I'm happy because I'm this great guru. She says, I'm not a guru. What are you talking about? I'm just visiting my friends. I'm just here to visit my dear friends. I just came here to this world. Why'd you come here? Because I came here to see you. I mean, I'm thrilled to see you. This is how she was. Then Jesus came back, he's back in the world. He told the whole world. And I heard, he said, I'm just back here to visit my dear friends. That's why I'm here. That's the only reason I'm here. Because there's so many of my friends here, my best friends. And it's just like, I can't stay away. I'm just thrilled to be back here. Visit my friends. This is how they are. This is the truth. Because they see us as having perfect standing with God. Immaculate, perfect standing forever. So they're just like, oh, you know, I get to visit some of my family, my perfect family members. This is just awesome for me. This is the attitude they give you. They don't come in here and say, you know, I'm someone of great attainment. I'm the greatest attainer of all times. I've gone through this, and I went through that, and I went through this, and I know how to do this, and I know how to do this. And you're just so incredibly fortunate. I'm giving you the opportunity to come see me because I'm so awesome. That is not a true guru. You know, gotta tell you this. It is not. That's a personality cult guru. The real guru is crying because they're so happy to see you. That's the real guru. They said, wow, you know, you've been trying to hide from me for so long, but now you gave me the opportunity to see you. This is awesome for me. That's the real guru. I mean, they're searching for you. This is the truth. They say, I want to meet my friends, but they're hiding from me. They're trying to avoid me, you know, but finally you stopped hiding so I can see you, my dear brother. You're my friend. You're my family. You're part of my family forever. And finally I get to see you. Oh, this is so wonderful for me. And they're crying. They're so happy. That's the real, those are the real gurus. Believe me, I know this is a fact. It's unmistakable. It's genuine. You know, it's genuine. It's not an act. It's not, oh, come here, let me hug you. I'm some great, awesome guru. I'm going to give you some of my love. Or something. You know, no. It's like they feel that you are giving them your love. It's the love that you're giving them that they're feeling. You know, it's not like, here, come, I'm the queen of all love, I'm going to give my love to you. No. It's like they're experiencing that you're giving them the love. And they're so, it's like, oh, this is just so great. They're coming to see you. And they thank you for the opportunity. It's just, you know, they're just like, thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to experience, you know, your love, you know, because you're perfect. You have this perfect love, you know, and they just, they're thrilled to experience this. This is the real, these are the real teachers. And you think, does such one exist? Yeah, absolutely they do, absolutely they do. That's how they see it. Each one of us has this perfect, perfect standing in God, absolute freedom. And we're all, you know, totally awesome, beyond anything imaginable we can even say. And yet we've been pretending that we're not. And so the ones that are not pretending, you know, they yearn for us to drop our pretension. And so they can experience us, you know. Well, they see through our pretension, so they're able to experience us as we truly are. At the same time, they realize that we're suffering, you know. And it's easier to experience it than it is to explain it. You know, it's better to experience it. So it's not that the guru says, well, I'm so great. It's that they say, you're so great. And they're not talking, obviously, if you say, yeah, but my personality, I'm such a fan. They're not talking about your personality. They're not talking about that. They don't come from the God of projection, the continuity, fear, ego. They don't come from there. You know, so where'd you come from? I mean, we're astonished. What is this? Well, they come from the true God. They treat you like you're a member of their own family, and you're like this, you know, valuable member of their family. Invaluable. You're absolutely invaluable, irreplaceable. They treat you like you have irreplaceable value that can never be lost to them, you know, that can never be diminished at all. Undiminishable, untouchable, irreplaceable value. That's their attitude they have towards you, the real teachers. The real gurus, the real sages. It's not come to see me and be awed about how sagey I am, you know. That's not it. So when we see Jesus, it's not, oh, Jesus, oh, I've come to the greatest teacher of all time. Oh, you're, no, it's not about that. It's that he's the one who's happy to see you. Don't put the personality in the way. He says, oh, no, no. He says, I'm just thrilled that you have, you know, this inestimable value, this irreplaceable value that can never be diminished in any way. He says, to me, you have this irreplaceable value, can never be diminished in any way. Why? Because all of your experiencing, I also experience. So you're giving me the gift of all of your freedom of experiencing to me, which is irreplaceable value. Irreplaceable value. So literally, they see you this way because it's true. We all have irreplaceable value that's untouchable, can never be diminished in any way. They're aware of this, so they treat you like, they treat everyone like they're these awesome VIPs. Awesome VIPs. And it's not an act, it's real. So you cannot help but be brought to tears by this and moved by it. You know, it moves mountains off of you. Yeah. It the mountain is moved off of you instead of on top of you. What the personality does is moves mountains of doom upon you, a fear of I'm potentially doomed as far as spirit goes. They dump that whole mountain of heaviness upon you, whereas the real teachers lift mountains of concern and fear off of you. They lift the whole mountain off of you. Right now the world's in a situation where the mountain's going to crumble on top of us as we accept the God of projection as our God, you know, the person, God of the personality. This puts a mountain of doom upon, a feeling of doom upon us. The real teachers lift that mountain of doom off of us. They really do. I know this for a fact. Now, can we find these real teachers? Well, can we let them find us is the question. And we're practicing this wow so that we allow it. This is the wow, we allow it because we will be overwhelmed by this, you know. And, you know, I went through this experience. I was overwhelmed by Sri Sri Anandamayi. I couldn't speak. I was so overwhelmed by it, I could not even speak. There was just tears coming down my cheeks. I couldn't speak. But I could abide in this, so I was still functional. I had a functional abidance in this experiencing. For a moment, projections, you know, were lifted off of me. I experienced someone not projecting anything upon me at all. And then when that was lifted off me, I felt the truth of my being, which is I'm perfect. And this is just, so I was speechless. What can I say? And then I said, hey, people, this is possible. I want to tell the world, hey, this is possible. But, you know, the world wouldn't listen. They're listening to projection. How can we learn to project properly and find out where the bad stuff is and get rid of it? You know, where's the failure? Project the failure. Personality's always trying to figure out how to properly project the failure. A proper projection of failure. And then identify where the failure is and then get rid, you know, wipe out that failure. This is the personality. So that's what it's trying to do. It's saying, well, I'm not projecting properly. How can I learn to project properly? Of course, there is no way to do that properly. It's to drop, is to call all our projections back home and not project. There's no reality. It's not projecting at all. It's not trying to dissociate at all. So the whole way the personality is going about it doesn't work at all. They're trying to, how do I project successfully, successful projection, so that I become a new self? You know, this is false path. It's a false path. Becoming a new self is the false path. That's the path of personality projection, listening to continuity fear, believing that advice is coming from God. So I was greatly blessed. How did I find Sri Ananda Maima? Well, she found me. I had this feeling I had to go to this store one day. It was a powerful feeling. I had to go there, and I had to look for some New Age music. And I found, I was looking through, I couldn't find anything I liked. And I found this CD of satsang, Sankirtana, Nama Sankirtana or something. I said, what is this? This seems very spiritual and everything. I had this picture of this woman on the cover, and I said, who the heck is that? I had never seen anybody like that before. I said, something struck me about her. Yeah, I said, this is very different than anything I've ever seen before. I don't know what it is. And I said, oh, well, I'm not going to buy this, whatever. And when they wandered around the store a little more, I came across this book. Had the picture. I went through the book and looked through it, and there's a picture again. I said, who's that? I said, I've never seen one like that before, but I thought it was someone different. I said, well, this is interesting. And I think a third picture I came across somehow of this. I said, wow. This is really, I'm really interesting. This day is happening. Something's happening here. And it wasn't until later, I saw a video of this picture of Sri Ananda Maima. I said, wow. Again, I feel that someone's very unique. There's something very unique about them. I don't know what it is. I didn't know it was the same person. And then later on, it suddenly dawned upon me. I said, wait a minute. Is this all the same person? Different pictures of, you know, their life, the different phases. I went and checked, and I said, my gosh, it's the same person. I thought it was three different people at first. Then I said, well, who is this? So then I got the rent of the video. I came home, put it in, and first media right off the bat, it just kaboom. You know, there's no projection upon me of anything. No issues of failure being projected upon me whatsoever. And that's when I just struck dumb. You know, I struck speechless. So how did that happen? You know, the Holy Spirit arranged it, is how it happened. Grace of God arranged it, is how it's happened. How did I, you know, come across this waiter? Well, grace of God. So, how do we, it's a helpless feeling, isn't it, though, that we feel, well, how do I come across this? Because we, you know, they find us, we don't find them. And it's tough. There's no question. It's tough. But then when I found out she had passed away, I was distraught. You know, I said, oh my gosh, this is terrible. So I tried to work with pictures and tell the world about it, but people, you know, didn't get it. They just didn't get it. They say, well, how's this going to help us learn how to project properly? She's not projecting at all. How does this help us become perfect projectors? Well, it doesn't. But it turns us on the path of calling our projections home, which is real, which is the true salvation, because then we no longer have any feeling any need that we need to project at all. So we don't need to become perfect projectors. And we're not projecting failure in anyone else, so, you know, we're enlightened, truly enlightened. Up to that point, I didn't believe it was possible that there'd be someone with no issues. Now, I was aware of Ron Maharshi, but he's such a high example that, you know, it's initially it's difficult because he's just sitting there, not saying anything, you know, not doing anything, not projecting anything. Whereas Ananda Maima was moving in the world constantly, which is easier to relate with. See, in our Western society, we're constantly busy, especially in the Silicon Valley. Every second we're under pressure. Or a sense of urgency. So to see someone who function in a way with all this urgency around them and intensity and yet still not be projecting, this was like a revelation to me. I said, my gosh, it's possible even in the Western world, in the situation I'm in, it's possible to function in that way. So this is what was so extraordinary to me. And ultimately, then, this helped me see Ram Maharshi, you know, the value that he has is just, it's, he doesn't even need to do anything at all in the world because he knows everything's perfect. There's no need to even do anything at all. And so it's very profound. Ram Maharshi is so profound in that, in this way. It's not easy for us to get to that. You have to be very mature to see this on the path. He said, I don't need to say anything, I don't need to do anything. Because you're, and he's telling us, look, you don't either. You're perfect without saying anything or doing anything. You don't have to say anything or do anything. I already see your perfection. It's completely beyond any doing or saying whatsoever. So, this is what the great gurus do. The true gurus, they see you. You're, what you are is totally beyond any saying or any doing whatsoever. And they know you to be that. They know you to be that. And Ramana, the way he treated everyone was just awesome. That's not emphasized enough. I mean, he was just incredible. Everybody who came here was his precious, was precious to him. Came to the ashram, was precious to him. Feed them, treat them like they're, you know, greater than the king and queen of the universe, which they are. We are. We're greater than that. Treat them that way. Treat everyone that way. And he wouldn't eat anything until everybody had been fed and treated perfectly. He insisted that everyone be given this VIP treatment in the ashram. This is Ram Maharshi. And he was just the humble servant of all, just making sure everyone got the VIP treatment. He just sit there quietly, saying nothing, you know. But everyone felt that they had been just treated like, you know, that they were invaluable. He made everyone feel they were absolutely invaluable, without needing to say anything or do anything. Their invaluableness was not based on anything they said or did. Not whatsoever. It was intrinsic. It was inherent. It was untouchable. It was undiminishable. These are the real gurus, the real sages, the real saviors. And they render us speechless. And yet, so we're preparing for that. We're preparing for the real teachers here. You know, we've gotten past the personality cult teachers. You know, it is a very great effort, very great difficulty. But, you know, we're getting past that. That's evaporating. We've evaporated a lot of that now. A lot of it. So that was a miracle. Finding out this weight is a miracle on the 31st. I mean, I tell you this, the dates, the great dates for me are October 21st, which is when Jesus started transmitting A Course in Miracles to Helen Schuckman. That's a great date in the history of this world. One of the greatest bodies of teaching that's ever been given out anywhere in this universe, actually, started on that date, October 21st. Not saying that it's completely superior, I'm saying, but it's in that echelon of, you know, untouchably great teachings, okay? Whatever else is in that echelon of untouchably great teachings, A Course in Miracles is in that echelon. Absolutely it is. And this is not just here in this world, but in this entire universe. You're not going to find anything, you know, that is in some higher echelon. It's in the highest echelon, okay, universally, as far as a universally great teaching. And that started October 21st, 1965. So that's a huge date. Secondly, Sri Sri Ananda Mahima found me on October 27th and said, "Hey, look, I was here. You know, this is possible. This is how I see you. It's possible to be in a active scenario and still experience. The guru can find you even in an active lifestyle." So I thought, "You have to be in a cave somewhere." And she says, "No, the guru can find you even when you're in this active Silicon Valley lifestyle, modern world, tech world, whatever. The guru can still find you." That was October 27th, 1997. So that's a huge, hugely important date, not just for me, for everyone, that it proves, I became convinced that even in this super busy world, the world that we're in now, and the way that's going, the guru can still find you. And I became convinced of this, October 27th, 1997. November 2nd, 2013, I put out a great cry on the 1st for help. I said, "This is too much. Somehow, you know, the world is too much for us in this personality cult teachings of the world, spiritual personality cult teachings. Somehow, we're desperate. You know, we're failing." I said, I put out a cry for help. "Can anybody help us? Give us more help. You know, we need more help. Please help us out." And then the night of November 1st. And on the morning of November 2nd, Longchenpa, the great radical Dzogchen teacher, the great teacher, let's just say teacher, you know, the great teacher, Longchenpa, found me and said, "Yeah, I heard your plea, and I've answered it." November 2nd, 2013. So these dates here, you know, the 21st, it's like a 10-day period, isn't it, basically? It's a little more than that. Maybe a 11-day period. 12, yeah, 13, whatever. Let's say a 2-week period. Yeah, let's round it up. Okay, there's this 2-week period from the 21st of October through the 2nd of November, which have been keystone events, you know, for us spiritually. We have to realize we have a tradition. We have a spiritual culture here. These are not little things that happen. These are huge, huge, hugely important dates of happenings. I'm right here. I was on October 27th, 1997. I was at the end of my rope, and I said, "Look, I've done everything I can do. I can't do anymore. It's not working. The world is too much with us. The personality cult is too strong. There's nothing we can do, and it can't get through to us. It cannot." And so I was basically ready to just quit this life. This is what happened. And I said, "Well, you know, I just got to throw my life away. It's no longer, it can't work here. It can't work." That's when Sri Sri Ananda Mahima said, "Hey, look. Look at this example. It can work." Because she was in this whirl around her, you know, just intense. The world was intensely swirling around her constantly. And she was able to completely handle it perfectly, you know. So she's saying, "Yes, it can happen here. Don't give up. Yes, it will happen here," you see. So this was monumentally helpful for everyone in this world. Is that vibe, I've been radiating that vibe ever since. and not giving up. This was a spiritually helpful event that happened. I just happened to be the one that it happened to, being in the heart of it here, the heart of the monster here, living in the heart of this monster. This is the Silicon Valley is the monster that is promoting this global personality cult as the future. And so to have that happen, you know, here, and to anchor it here is an extraordinarily important event in history, actually, for our spiritual welfare. And then for Longchenpa to also answer the call here, because the intensity now is becoming off the charts, is also a historically important event that took place, spiritually speaking. So we have the spiritual family, and these events are part of our spiritual family's heritage, actually. So we have this heritage that is still ongoing now. Okay, this is very important to get this through. And I just happen to be fortunate enough to be part of this. But it's for everyone. It's for everyone. It's part of our spiritual heritage. I've been able to contribute to that. You know, that's a blessing for, you know, to be able to do that. For me, I feel that's a blessing to be able to do that. No matter how intense the world is with us, we can still be found. The teachers will still find us. They will still reassure us. And of course, in miracles, right, was another important day, the 21st of October, 1965, that Jesus said, "Hey, you know, I know the world is going towards this personality cult, but you know what? We can beat that. You know, we can get free of it. I know you can do it. Here's a way to do it. I'm not turning my back on you just because you're all going towards this personality cult. I want to reassure you, I have not turned my back on you in any way whatsoever. I still see you as perfect as you are, even though you're pursuing this destiny, this terrible destiny. You know, you talk about helpful. So I'm saying for sure that you know, we need to, however we're going about it, is a fact that part of our spiritual heritage, these dates are resonate, very important resonation. These are great, great events. You talk about, you know, the Buddha, enlightenment of the Buddha, you talk, whatever events in history you want to talk about spiritually, these are right there in that same echelon. That's the same echelon of importance, really. Of Course in Miracles, that is extremely high. You know, it's the highest echelon of importance in terms of reassurance, in terms of reassuring us, because we were headed into the mouth of the whale. You know, the monster we're walking into the mouth of the monster, which is going to swallow us up. This is what we've done. We have literally, there's this big mouth, like a shark, huge mouth open, and we walked into this mouth of technology and what's happened now in the modern culture here, of this monster, and we're in the belly of the beast, you know, and the mouth is about ready to shut. In about 9 months' time, the monster's going to shut its mouth, you know, and we're saying, oh, we're in this, because we've been trying to perfect projection, perfect it, which means we project failure onto others. So here we are walking into the mouth of the monster. And here's Jesus saying, look, I'll never turn my back on you. And here's why. He says, you don't believe me? Here, study this, and you'll see that what I'm telling you is true. He says, no matter what you do, no matter whether you're in the belly of the beast, I'll never turn my back on you. You still have this undiminished, perfect value to me. Eternally, you know, immeasurable, undefinable value, which can never be diminished in any way. And he says, I know this is a fact, as a fact, and I'll never stop seeing this as a fact. And you don't believe me? Give me the chance. Just hear me out, and here's A Course in Miracles. Just read this, study it, hear me out, consider it, just Can you do that for me? That's all I ask of you, is at least hear my side of this, of things, you know, hear my side of it. You're ready to commit your life to the continuity fear and to the ego, commit your destiny. You're trying to commit forever to this destiny. So before you do that, just at least give me a little time to let me present my side of things here. Okay, you've only listened to the ego. Give me just a little of your time, please, to let me present my side of it, my perspective. That's all I'm asking of you. That's all it is. So that's what I did. I said, okay, you know, I'll give you a fair hearing. You know, I said, I can't promise you I'm going to agree with you, but I'll give you a fair hearing. Because that's only fair. I said, if we're going to make this commitment to the ego, it's only fair that we understand what is it that we're turning against, you know? Fair is fair, you know? So the ego's saying, look, you know, we're going to make this huge commitment to the ego forever and turn our backs on God forever. Well, at least God, you know, should have, you know, before the execution, should have the opportunity to state what he wants to state. You know, and Jesus on the behalf of God stated, you know, what God wants to state. So I said, okay, that's fair. Fair is fair. But I said, no promises, you know. I'm not promising that I'm going to agree with what you say or accept what you have to say or anything like that. I'm not promising, but I will give you the floor and let you listen to what you have to say. Because this is a big decision we have coming up here. Are we going to commit to this artificial intelligence future and all of this or not? Are we going to walk all the way into the belly of beast and let it shut its mouth on us? This is the artificial intelligence and the future that this lays out for us, the destiny, you know, perfecting projection, automating it, perfecting it, making it automatic, you know, and you know. So I said, let's get down to work here, Jesus. Let me give you a fair hearing. So I want to know what you're saying. So I started studying. I said, what are you saying? Let me understand it. And I said, I can't quite understand it. So I didn't feel it was fair. I want to truly understand what he's saying in order so I can say it's fair judgments here. Say, okay, you know, I heard you fairly. I truly heard what you had to say. So now I can compare, you know, which do I want? That's all he said, saying, hey, before you try to leave me forever, can you make a fair assessment of your decision? I just want you to feel you're making a fair decision either way, you know, either way, just a fair decision that you feel is honestly fair. So I said, okay, that is fair enough. With fair enough, we have a deal here. And ego would say, wow, you've listened enough to Jesus. I said, well, I don't quite understand what he's saying. I think it's my fault. It's not that he's not expressing himself clearly. It's that I'm having trouble, you know, hearing his viewpoint here. I gotta study it more because it's not fair yet. I can't make a fair decision, an honest decision yet. And the ego says, are you ready yet? Come on, make a fair decision. I said, no, not yet. I'm not ready yet. Well, surely you understand. I said, no, not quite. No. He's there's something he's getting at that I'm still fuzzy about, you know? So it's not really, I can't make an honest, fair decision yet. Well, you know, it's almost 40 years later. You know, I'm still working on it. Which is only fair, you know. I'm getting there. I'm hearing, you know, more and more I'm hearing what he has to say. And he's speaking on behalf of all of us and God, you know, telling us this is God's position on this whole situation. And that God will never stop seeing us as being perfect creations. He'll never change in the slightest bit the way that we're viewed. He says it's impossible. So that We'll never change God's opinion and outlook and perspective upon us. We'll never change that. This is what he tells us. And he also tells us what we're trying to do, you know. It'll never work. It'll never make us happy. We'll always feel this intrinsic fear of doom. Artificial intelligence won't change that for us. You know, we think it will. We think that the artificial intelligence will enable us to program our projections and make them automatic and make them powerful and make them amplify them and make them smooth and make them perfect. And, you know, and he points out the flaw, that this is inherently flawed. The whole thing is flawed from the very beginning. And he'll never turn his back on us. Even if we do go down that road, he'll never turn his back on us. He never turned his back on us. We turned our back on him and said, you know, well, let us take what you sold us and see if we can perfect our projections. And he realized, well, that's not what I told you, but I won't turn my back on you. But you're going to go down that road and see if it works. And now at some point you're going to realize, hey, that doesn't work. And then you're going to either double down on it or not. This is why we decided to turn back. You say, hey, Jesus, you know, we're about ready to turn our backs on you for a long, you know, try to totally do it through artificial intelligence. So we feel there's something about you. We want to honor you. You know, we want to give you a fair hearing here because we're about ready to reject you completely. And we feel like there's something you did for us 2,000 years ago that was so wonderful that we want to give you a final, give you the opportunity to have a final say here. And so he did. And we've given him this opportunity for a final say, and some have listened to it, you know. We said, we owe you that. As we're ready to turn our back on you entirely, we owe you this, you know, to give you a fair hearing here. Because we felt that you're fair, very fair. You know, there's some impression you made upon us that you're very honest and fair. And so we don't want to be dishonest and unfair to you. So here, go ahead. We'll give you the opportunity. You have the floor. Say what you want to say. We're not going to say what you have to say. You say whatever you want to say. We owe you at least that. Say whatever you want to say, and we'll listen to what you have to say and give it a fair hearing. That's all I've done. You know, that's what I did. I said, okay, this is my feeling. Okay. So this made it possible. You know, we said, hey, we don't want to turn our back on you without giving you one final chance to give, you know, to say what you want to say. Because we feel you really are a very, very fair and honest, you know, being. And so you've earned that right. Well, he used the opportunity then to give us a Course in Miracles, which is really just his statement, you know. This is what I want to tell you. This is what I want you to hear. This is my perspective. And, you know, so, you know, now we have this to judge. Now we have artificial intelligence, you know, saying, they, you know, there's a way to make projection perfect. And they're going in that direction. And so, this is where it stands. So, maybe Jesus has come back and he wants to thank those who have given him a fair hearing, you know? Just thank him. He doesn't say, well, that means you have to go with me or not. I mean, I don't think there's that stipulation put upon it. Just like I told Jesus, look, there's no guarantee I'm going to side with you, you know? But I'll give you a fair hearing. But maybe Jesus is back and said, look, you don't have to say that you're going to side with me or not. I just want the opportunity to thank you for giving me a fair hearing. So, you know, I want to give him that opportunity, absolutely. He's got the right, you know, he's got the right to thank me. I've given him a fair hearing. There's no doubt about it. I don't have it. I'm not going to make say for sure that I'm going to side with Jesus. Even at this point, no, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying it. Neither am I saying it, nor am I not saying it. But I feel he has the right to thank me. I want to give him that opportunity. Because I have truly given him a fair hearing. This is true. Same with Sri Srinivasa, same with Ram Maharshi, same with Longchenpa. I've given them a fair hearing, you know. I really have. And especially with Jesus, I can say I truly have continually worked it through. So I hear what he's saying. I hear what he's saying. Maybe not perfectly, but honestly and fairly, I would say. It doesn't have to be perfect. He said it doesn't have to be perfect. You know, there's still some fuzziness, a little bit of fuzziness here and there. That's okay, you know. But by and large, you know, I get the gist of it. So I would say it's very likely that Jesus, because he said, "I'm just come back as just to hang out with you as a friend," and I just want to thank those who give me a fair hearing. That's all he's really here for. Now, which way we decide, artificial intelligence or you know, it's okay with him because, you know, he's still not going to turn his back on us, no matter you know ever, because he's not going to turn his back on truth. You know, I did what I promised I would do. I give him a fair hearing. So, and that's all he asked of us. So maybe he's just here to thank us for that. You know, the ones that did that, he just say, thank you. That's it. What more can he do? What more can he do? You know, he can't force us to decide one way or the other. And I still don't know which way I'm going to go, you know? But at least I can give these teachers opportunity, you know, to give their thanks. That's what they want. That's what I believe now. What else can they do? You know? I've heard what he has to say. There's nothing he can really say. There's nothing that Jesus can say, really, at this point to me that is going to make really a difference one way or the other as far as saying anything. I know what he has to say. So, but, you know, letting him thank me for it, you know, he's got the right. Maybe that'll help, maybe it won't. I don't know, but he still has the right. I don't have the right to say no, you know. Will that tip me towards artificial intelligence? I don't know. I really don't know. See, I don't know, but he does have the right, you know. I give him the right. I acknowledge he has the right to thank us. I mean, if we do something for somebody that they feel is really tremendous, don't they have the right to say thank you? I can't deny him that. I can't deny these teachers. I can't deny them that opportunity, you know. That would be cruel. It would be cruel. So we've really flipped the script here, haven't we? It's a very profound flipping of the script. Very intense here. Very emotional, very intense. To flip the script like this is just, it's off the charts. But, you know, I'm fine. It's just it's very intense. Wow. So they're really coming, asking us permission for the right. This was so amazing, you know, such an astonishing turnaround here of perspective. They're coming to ask us if they have the right to sit with us, actually. Wow. They're the beggars, you know. They're the beggars. They're begging us. Can I just sit with you? Can I just thank you? That's what Sri Sri Nandamayama said, you know, if you just see God as a beggar coming, begging from you, begging, please. Look at it that way. And you see, this puts you in the right position to enable it to happen. Wow. That's why I've never been able to go to any guru, find any guru to go to, you know, in terms of these great personality gurus, you know. The Holy Spirit always blocks it, says no, no, no. I tried to force it a couple times and the Holy Spirit showed me very clearly this is not it for you. It's there, the great gurus are coming, want to come see you know, to thank you for giving them a fair hearing. And you're not letting it happen because you think that is, you have to make a decision, then no. They're not trying to force a decision on us. They just want to the opportunity to at least thank you for a fair hearing. That's very important for them. That's all they ask for, is a fair hearing. And very few give them that opportunity. You know, Anandamayima said, in the whole time she was here, there was a handful, few. She says, there's some. Very few came and gave her a fair hearing at all. So, it's a big deal for them to thank those who did give them a fair hearing. It's a big deal. So it can be very cruel to deny them that. Very, very cruel to deny them this. It would be like a slap in the face, you know. So this is the issue I've been struggling with. You know, I say, no. You're not coming to see me. I'm coming to see you. But, you know, you're the... You know, they say, no, that's not right. We're coming to see you. I say, who am I that you should come to see me? That's, you know, you got it backwards. They say, no. Because truly, they don't view us as any less than they are at all. They don't view themselves as greater than us, not in the slightest bit. They see us as totally valuable to them. Our freedom of experiencing is invaluable to them. It completes them. And without our freedom of experiencing, they're not what they are, you know. They're not complete. So it's all important to them that we give them a fair hearing about this issue, you know? So to them, we're VIPs. I mean, you know, so this is the truth. This is the real truth of the situation. And people always felt like, you know, that I'm crazy to see it this way, that, you know, Jesus, we need to worship Jesus. We're nothing. You're God, and we're these terrible sinners. I said, no. This is not right. You got it all backwards. And then I said, someday Jesus is going to come and see me. And they said, you're crazy. You know, you're an egomaniac. You know, all the stuff I got. I said, no, this is true. You got it all wrong here in the world. Upside down and backwards. You know, didn't Jesus wash the feet of his disciples and said, this is the way it is? Now, this was symbolic. He's not meaning that you need to be some great social worker. He was showing you that, he was saying, look, you gave me a fair hearing. That's all I ask of you, because I'm incomplete without you. Without you accepting your true freedom, what you are, pretending you're not, I'm not getting the true richness of experiencing that I deserve too. You know, I'm incomplete. So he came to wash the feet of his apostles because they gave him a fair hearing, at least to a small extent. Yeah. Look. You know, he humbled himself to his apostles. And the personality has put that into the personality context, which is the wrong context, which is why the world is going to hell, you know, in the belly of the beast. Why I'm so outspoken about this. Now, I mean, they're trying to have their cake and eat it too. So they can't imagine that Jesus would come back just to humble himself and thank those who gave him a fair hearing. And that's it, you know, that's all he's here for. They haven't quite connected the dots, you know. I mean, there is a good message, for instance, in Christianity, of being the humble servant of all. Absolutely. And the yoga of the East is the seva, the path of service. This is a very big path that a lot of people are on. That's all well and good. But that is still not giving a fair hearing to what Jesus is saying. They're still, just like Ananda Maimonides said, don't call me mother. Don't call me the Divine Mother. That distances you. You're putting me on a pedestal. This is not what I'm here for. I'm just here to give me a fair hearing. I'm, you know, you're equal to me. And she said, you go look at it that way, you're creating this distancing. Same thing with Jesus. Christianity has created distancing. This prevents the fair hearing from taking place. So I never did that. I said, look, I can be fair to you. I'll give you a fair hearing. I'm not going to put you on this pedestal. Just talk straight with me, you know? As equal, just talk. You want to, because they want to talk as equal. So I gave them an opportunity to talk as to me as an equal. I'll give you that opportunity, because if you don't do that, projection. You feel you have to keep projection in place, you know. And they're saying you got to call all projections back home. So then you can't quite give them a fair hearing. It's not possible. So I said, all right, do you want to talk to me as an equal? I'll give you that opportunity. No, still it was difficult. Because it's like, what? Like, what are they saying? You know? Now, I don't know. It's, you know, speculation. How was I able to do that? I just felt, I don't know. I was used to being a big shot in my previous life and talking with, you know, the biggest big shots around in Europe. And, you know, I stayed at the castles of the wealthiest people in the world. And they related to me as equals because I had a great talent as a composer. So the door was open to me to relate to these big shots, and there was an equal, you know. It wasn't like I was some they were condescending, you know. I had, back then, musical culture was the highest of high culture, and I was at the pinnacle of musical culture. So they treated me with respect, you know, the biggest industrialists, the wealthiest people in the world, the most powerful kings and queens and aristocracy, they treated me with respect. So I was used to dealing with the highest levels of this world, the power structure, and getting on an equal level with respect. So I didn't bow to anybody. So having this, and yet I was still a commoner, you know. I came out as dirt poor. I was born in north of Germany. Our family was dirt poor. Moved to Hamburg. Dirt poor. I had to play in brothels as a child just to earn money to keep the family alive, you know. We were dirt poor. So I didn't have this, you know, entitlement complex or anything. I earned it, you know, through talent and wanting to help people feel good about themselves. You know, I wanted to, you know, help lighten up the world and try to make us feel better. And I just worked as hard as I could. So I you know, earned status in this way, but that then brought me into the courts of Europe and gained this huge reputation, and then the aristocracy treated me, you know, with respect, cultural respect, because back then, high culture was seen as close to God, okay? It was coming from God. So back then, the aristocracy is still God-fearing, you know? I mean, so if someone had talent that they felt came from God, they gave respect to that. They really did. So did the industrialists. The industrialists were still had this feeling of God-fearing, you know, we call it that, but they had a feeling like that God was important somehow, something, you know, Jesus was still resonating with them in some way, okay. So I had this experiencing of being an equal with the most powerful people in the world. So I came into this life, I felt like, hey, I there's nobody that's above me. You know, I don't bow to anyone. But I'm used to just being honestly blue collar. Let's just be direct. You know, blue collar people are very direct and honest with one another. You know, they're not putting on airs. Let's just, you know, you tell me what's going on, I'll listen to you. So I had this blue collar work ethic. And at the same time, the experience of being treated as an equal by the most powerful people in the world. So it's a very unique situation. And so Jesus said, hey, would you give me a fair hearing? And I said, equal, would you treat me as an equal and give me a fair hearing, blue collar, straight, you know, on the level here. Give me a fair hearing that way. And I said, sure, I'll do it. Why not? Blue collar people will tell you what, you know, how they're feeling. You know, I live in blue collar world here, my world, and you know, when you get them together, they'll say, look, this is what I really feel. You know, they'll be honest with you. They're honest. There's a lot of blue collar, you know, honesty. This is where the honesty resides in. Those are trying to get wealthy. They're dishonest. Become very dishonest, and they don't tell you what they're really thinking. It's everything is image, everything is they're trying to, you know, work on you. But if you're blue collar and you get into the high echelons like I did, then they open up with you more. They feel like I can be myself around this guy, you know. And they can kind of let down, and so it's an amazing thing. And they'll level with you. So here's Jesus leveling with me. I said, okay, Jesus, you want to level with me? Okay, I'm used to that. I'm used to the, you know, the top powerful people leveling with me and treating me as an equal and everything, and trusting me and everything. So you want to level with me? Go ahead, I'll listen to you. Same with the other teachers, you know, I'll listen to you. I never felt like I'm this little worm, you know, that who am I to be giving Jesus a fair hearing, you know, because I was used to, again, hanging out with the most powerful people in the world in my previous life. And they're being treated as an equal and unleveling with me. Of course, Jesus is on a different, higher level than that. Right? I mean, but I was used to it, so it was a big deal, a big jump. But I say it's not too big of a jump. And he told me, no, you can do it, you can do it. And I said, oh yeah, okay. But you know, 40 years, almost 40 years later, it's a lot of doing there. A lot of listening and consideration. Yeah, I just sit there all day and consider, what is he saying? You know, just, I'm trying to consider what you're saying, but I don't quite get it. But people, you know, thought I was kind of aloof because it's just like, I didn't feel inferior to anybody. I felt I'm equal to anybody, you know, I mean, because I was used to it. Used to being treated that way. Used to being treated with respect, with deference. Somebody, the lower class people treat me with great deference, you know. But I'd say, no, you know, here. And I'd mingle with them because I'm blue collar, look, I'm dirt poor. I understand, you know, what it's like to have to work. I started working as a young child, little child. I had to work, just to earn money to survive, help my family survive. Didn't have an education. Music was my education. So I understand poverty. I understand blue collar. I understand all this. So I'm not aloof from that. Neither am I aloof from the higher up. So the blue collar people to look at me, so why are you talking with this higher up like you are on an equal level with them? You know, what are you trying to? I say, no, it's not like that. It's not. So it's kind of a unique situation that people don't quite get it. You know, they don't get me. They don't quite understand it. How are you able to feel, you know, that you can mingle with the highest echelon and also with us too?